Today is Tuesday, August 7th, 2013, and I'm Juliana Nykolaiszyn with the Oklahoma State University Library. Today we're interviewing Dr. Helen C. Miller as part of the O State Stories Oral History Project. Thank you for joining me today. Well, Dr. Miller, let's begin by learning a little bit more about you. Could you tell me the year you were born and where you were born?
Well, I was born in 1925 in Indianapolis, Indiana, to George and Lucy Carter. My mother was a German lady. Her real name was Louisa Ernestina Lydia Niehoff.
Wow.
And my father was George W. Carter, and his father was George W. Carter. And if you look back in the history of Jimmy Carter, you will find that there was a relationship with George W. Carter's for quite a while. And his ancestors are from Georgia, and he's part Cherokee Indian. My grandmother was part Cherokee.
And did you grow up in Indianapolis?
I grew up in Indianapolis, and it was during the Depression, of course, 1925. Those were Depression years, and we were part of the poor, so we didn't have very much money, and we lived rather frugally.
What did your parents do for a living?
My father, before the Depression, had bought a lot of rental houses, so he was living off of rental property income. And when the Depression hit, his renters couldn't pay the rent, so he lost several of those houses. And my mother had never worked before except as a cleaning lady. So we didn't really have a very steady income. That was the truth. Things fared better when the war was over, the First World War, Second World War, and my mother got a job she got a job, and that income helped. And my father started buying houses again, but we had quite a long time when we were pretty poor.
Did you have brothers and sisters?
No, I was an only child.
And during the Depression, could you tell that a depression was going on?
Oh, yeah. I was very aware of how poor we were because we often didn't have food. I remember one Christmas we had oatmeal for lunch on Christmas Day. I mean, just things like that. Mm-hmm. I never had any new clothes. But I'm not feeling sorry for myself. Mm-hmm. I'm saying this. It was just a fact of life.
What was school like for you during your early years?
Well, I walked to school. I went to grade school number 34 in Indianapolis, which was about two blocks from my house. It was an interesting school because it was a good school, and I learned a lot. And there was one black boy in that school. His family lived across the street from the school, and his parents were the janitors. You know, his mother was a maid, and his father was a janitor in the school. And it was interesting because I remember he was included in a lot of things that the people, he went through eight grades with us. And he was included in a lot of activities, but a lot of activities he wasn't included in either. When I graduated from high school, I went to Manual Training High School, which was a school. There were three big schools in Indianapolis at that time. One was technical school, and that taught people skills and trade stuff. And there was a manual training school, Emmerich Manual Training School. And that was a school, as it said, where they had lots of courses in wood cutting and cooking and stuff like that. I went there. I thought I would be a secretary all my life, and they taught typing and secretarial stuff. And it turned out that that was a very good academic school also, because I majored in English and history and education in case I'd ever have a chance to be a teacher. And when I got into the English class, my first English class was with a lady named Gretchen Camp, and she was also in charge of a school newspaper. So she invited me and a few other people to be on the booster staff, which the booster was the name of the school paper. And so I spent most of my time at Manual working on the booster in my spare time. I also spent a lot of time with two women who taught the physical education courses. And I know now they were lesbians. I didn't at the time. Didn't have any idea about that. But they were also very encouraging to me. And so I spent a lot of time in the gym. And at that time I was very physically active, and I became badminton champion and a champion on the parallel bars in the gym. And I eventually became school editor of the booster, you know, the student editor. That was in my senior year. But Gretchen Camp, to show you how good she was, later became head of the journalism department at the University of Indiana.
Wow.
Then she moved from Manual High School into that job at the university. She was wonderful. And I had a lot of really great other teachers also. So I had a very good education at this Manual training school. And from there, I went to Butler University.
Now, were your parents encouraging of you going to college?
Well, no, I never thought I would.
Uh-huh.
I never expected to go to college. I thought I'd either end up being I really expected most of my life I'd end up working in an office.
Mm-hmm.
But in my senior year, there was a chance to apply for scholarships to Butler. And there was a foundation in Indianapolis called the Indianapolis Foundation. And they gave scholarships to some students to go to college. And I applied, and I got one, full tuition and books for 4 years at Butler. Now, Butler is a private university, and it's a high-cost university. It's also a very good one. I had to spend 2 hours getting from my house on the south side of Indianapolis to Butler on the north side of Indianapolis, riding a bus all those years. But it was one bus load, one hour to get the Manual from my house. But anyway, the scholarships that year went in Manual to three of my best friends, the three of us who had worked on the booster all those years. And the three of us then on scholarship went to Butler. So they continued to be my friends in college.
Wonderful.
Yeah, it was wonderful. I'm very grateful to the Indianapolis Foundation. I sometimes wonder if they still do it. So that takes care of high school, where I was a nerd. My only non-A grades were in typing and shorthand.
Secretary, huh?
Secretary. So, but I didn't get I didn't get straight A's or anything like that,
mm-hmm.
because of those secretarial courses that I took. I wasn't any good at them. And the one summer in my probably junior year in high school, I worked in an office. It was the only year I ever did. One summer in high school, I worked selling hats, believe it or not, in a department store downtown. But that was my senior year when I didn't want to work in an office again. And I had been a Girl Scout. No, sorry, a Campfire Girl. My mother was a Campfire Girl leader, and I went to a camp called Camp Delight, and a lady who was running the camp came to me when I was selling hats and asked if I would like to work as a counselor at that camp. And I said, oh, yes. So that was how I spent my senior year summer, was at that camp as a counselor. And I taught nature study. Now, I didn't know a lot about nature, but that was the kind of counselor they needed. So what I did was have people make leaf spatters, prints, you know, and identified very common trees and common birds on field trips. But that was interesting because that was the beginning of nature study, you see, for me. Mm-hmm. And I worked at that camp for, I think, 3 summers as a nature counselor. And of course, I realized I didn't know very much. But by that time, I was at Butler. And so one of the first courses I took at Butler was botany. So I could learn more about trees and stuff. And because it was in 41, every boy who graduated with me from Manual was in the Army, drafted. So when I got to Butler, there were no men. It was mostly all women and a few 4F men. So the people who were teaching courses at Butler were without their usual men students. So after I took botany for 1 semester, which was a lab course, the instructor in that course asked me if I would proctor the labs next semester. So I became a proctor in botany labs. And I had that job for quite a few years at Butler. And at Butler, I was going to be and was an English history education major, same thing I majored in high school. And my English teacher that year was another really remarkable woman. She had a degree from Oxford University. And she took me in hand and really changed my life because she was so good. And she was so helpful, and she kept me employed the whole time I was at Butler so I could buy food and pay for transportation and stuff like that. So I worked on the yearbook for a couple of years and taught these biology labs as a proctor. And as a proctor, they gave me access to a herbarium in the botany department, so I had a place to put my books and hang out. And so that was where I met some people that were very influential. I learned something about classical music from another student. I learned to play chess from a student who was also hanging out in the herbarium. And I took all the botany courses that I could take at Butler. They were short courses in trees. You learned how to identify trees by bark, buds, leaves, and winter and summer. I learned how to identify ferns. I learned how to identify mosses and spring flowers. And because there were no men around, the botany professors had to take girls to do things with them. So the botany professor whose lab I was teaching in used to come by my house on weekends to take me on field trips. And for 4 years, I went on a lot of field trips in Indiana and learned the flora of Indiana. I learned how to identify plants, learned their scientific names, and learned a lot about, you know, the plants of Indiana and the Midwest. So this is important because later when I got to Cornell, I knew all the plants that were out there too. So, but anyway, I graduated from Cornell, from Butler, cum laude, because I didn't get to finish a paper that would have made me magna cum laude. But that was the main thing about Butler, was the fact that there were so few men, that women took their places and gave us opportunities we would never have had otherwise. I would never have had that kind of close relationship with botany professors if there had been a lot of men around. It just wasn't ever done. But this, we have to remember, this was a time when women were not doing very well in the world. There were no women teachers at Butler. And when I got to Cornell a few years later, there was only one woman in the College of Agriculture, the whole College of Agriculture. But anyway, back to high school, or back to Butler. When I graduated from Butler, I was offered a job. I didn't apply for this. I was offered a job at Manual High School as an assistant to the woman who was running the booster, which I'd worked at and been an editor for when I was in high school. Her sister was a friend of mine. And when she learned that I was graduating with an English major from high, from college, she offered me this job. I hadn't applied for it, but I didn't know what I was going to do when I got out of college. But I didn't have to look. I was offered the job, and I took it. So for 2 years after I graduated from college, I taught high school English and ran the school newspaper, the Booster, again.
So at Butler, you graduated with an English degree.
And a history degree and an education degree.
But not botany.
Not botany.
Or biology.
I had all those elective courses, but I wasn't a major.
Okay. Just an interest.
I know.
Okay.
But it's a good question, because I loved botany by this time, and I had already taken a course, a night class, at the University, Indiana University Extension in zoology while I was at Butler. No, this is when, I'm sorry, when I was teaching English and...
At Manual,
right. I took that course. So I was already beginning to think about this, you see. And then after 2 years of teaching high school, I had the nerve to apply to Cornell. And you ask, why Cornell? And the reason was, there was a man there named Palmer who wrote a book which I had been using for many years to help me when I was teaching these nature courses at the camps. I forgot to tell you that I went to numerous different camps as a nature counselor when I was in Butler. I had an experience at a nature camp in Michigan, and 2 years at a nature camp in Wisconsin, and 1 year at a nature counselor in Connecticut. And all this time, see, I was a nature counselor, and I was using this man's book to help me to do a lot of stuff. And so he was from Cornell, so I wrote to him and asked if I could be admitted. And he said he could not accept me, but he said that I should apply to the botany department. And I did, and they accepted me with just those two-hour courses that I'd had at Butler. But the reason I learned somewhat later that they took me was because the botany department at Cornell was in a building with 5 stories. These were labs, offices, research facilities, and 1 floor for graduate students. And when I got there, there were 4 women on that floor, and three of us were new. They wanted women. They really were trying to get women, you see. I wasn't aware of this at first, but I really realized it later. The one woman who didn't start at the same time I did was from India, and she was getting her PhD in botany from India. So when I walked into that lab for the first, that aisle of, you know, offices, it was all men, and there were two women in an office next to me, and they became, of course, my really good friends during those years I was at Cornell.
What motivated you to want to go to grad school in the first place? What did you hope to accomplish?
Well, okay, I hated being an English teacher. I really did. I was lousy at it. And I, you know, most of my time I spent with the booster, but I had to teach English classes. And I didn't like grading papers. And it was hard to make those kids big classes, you know, interested in literature or writing. And they had to write, and I had to grade all those papers. And I didn't like grading papers. I didn't like teaching English. I wasn't good at it. At least I thought I wasn't. I don't think I was good at it. I know I wasn't. So I wanted to get out of that. I wanted to teach in biology. But I knew I had to do a lot to get qualified. But by that time, you see, I'd had this course in zoology, and I'd had read this book and taught nature study at camps. So when I got to Butler in the botany department, I wasn't ill-prepared. And one of the, this is sort of interesting because there was a man, there was a young man in that aisle of graduate students at Cornell first year. His name was Dan Ward, and he was from Crawfordsville, Indiana, and he was a taxonomist. He wanted to be a taxonomist, and he also knew the flora of Indiana very well. But when we took the flora of New York together, I beat him on lab tests all the time. And so he and I became really good friends. But and right now he is retired from the faculty at the University of Florida where he taught taxonomy and wrote the flora of Florida. But anyway, that was my heritage, you see, from going out for years with this teacher in biology or in botany at Butler. I was really pretty equipped in some fields of botany. But anyway, I took all the botany courses that you had to take to get a degree and got a degree in botany. For another year, I stayed on trying to decide whether I could get a PhD or find a job or whatever. And then during that year, one of my friends at Cornell was a woman named Nan, and she lived in Nantucket. So Nan was on leave from the University of Miami University in Ohio, where she taught biology to non-major students. And she had taken a leave of absence and promised to go back after 2 years. And she had decided she was going to get married and go live on Nantucket. So she told her department head she wasn't coming back, but she recommended me for the job. See? And I was offered the job. No interview, no nothing. He took her word for it. The man who was department head called me, and I had to decide over the phone whether I wanted to take that job. Well, it had been a year and I hadn't decided on a PhD program at Cornell. So I took the job. No interview, no nothing. See, that's the second time. And I went and I taught at Miami University in Ohio for 2 years. And I really kind of enjoyed that period of time because it was teaching biology, which I loved, and I thought I was doing an okay job. I had met some really nice people, had a really wonderful history there. The first year that I was there, I went on a American Youth Hostels trip to Europe. And I think that was, beg your pardon. I took the American Youth Hostel, first youth hostel trip earlier. I spent 8 weeks in Europe bicycling. And the next year, I led a group to the West Coast and back of youth hostlers. Mm-hmm. And the third year, I took a trip with youth hostlers to Europe. And that year was the second year that I was at Cornell. And Dan Ward met me over there, and we did hostling for 4 weeks together over there, and that was a fun time too. See, Dan Ward was really a very good friend of mine, and we had a wonderful time there with lots of experiences. But I got off track, didn't I, because I was teaching in Miami. And the second year at Miami, I decided, instead of going to Europe and leading another trip, which I could have done, I was going to take a course in invertebrate zoology. Remember, I hadn't taken much zoology, and I'd taken a zoology course, summer course at Cornell once. Well, anyway, went to North Carolina's biological station that summer, and that's where I met Rudy Miller. And he asked me to marry him, and I didn't decide right away either. And so I went to the University of Wisconsin for a semester to try to start a PhD in zoology. And up there I became an ethologist. That's a person who studies, that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to get my degree in ethology. And I was going to work on crows and blue jays, but they were very hard to study, because the sexes are the same. And well, anyway, I knew I was in for a struggle. So after 1 year at the University of Wisconsin, I married Rudy, and we went to New Orleans, where he was getting a master's degree. That's very short story of that thing. Mm-hmm. We got married in Miami. We got married in Oxford, Ohio, where all my University of Miami friends were with me. And then the next, from then on, it's a story of me and Rudy. But the first year we lived in New Orleans, I was sick a lot the early part of the time I was there, and I had to go to the hospital. And at the hospital, because I'd been married in an Episcopal church, when I entered the hospital, Rudy put down our religious affiliation as Episcopalian, and an Episcopal priest visited me in the hospital. Mm-hmm. And he was asking me about my background, just in a friendly sort of way. And when I told him that I had been teaching biology before I got married, he just perked up and he said, "Really? In college?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, have you ever taught it in high school?" And I said, "No." And he said, "Well, we have an opening at the Episcopal school for a biology teacher." Third time. And I said, "Oh." And so I got the job as a biology teacher at the Episcopal Church School in New Orleans. And that's how I spent the year that Rudy was, second year that Rudy was getting a master's degree. I was teaching down there. And it was a wonderful experience. I really enjoyed it. And I met a woman there named Florence Swan, who was an art teacher. And Florence took me under her wing, and I think I learned an awful lot from her. But anyway, she used to pick me up in the morning and take me out there and take me home. And so I was in her car a lot, and she showed me around New Orleans and showed me a lot of interesting places. And I remember she was so clued to beauty that she knew every tree in New Orleans that had any color in it in the fall. And in the fall, she took me around to see all these individual trees that were orange or yellow or, you know, some other color. That year, when I was teaching there, was a very unusual year for New Orleans. They had their first snowstorm ever.
Wow.
Yes. And it snowed and it snowed. And the kids, I can remember seeing this happening because I was in class. The kids were looking out the window and they couldn't believe this was happening. You know, here was snow coming down. The first thing you know, everybody poured out the doors to be in the snow. They'd never seen snow before. And the snow came down, it covered red poinsettias in flower, all the lovely flowers that are blooming in the fall. And snow piled up a little, and people made snowmen, and they even put them on their cars and drove around with melting snowmen on their cars for a couple of days. But that was a very interesting experience, snow in New Orleans. It was in December. I don't think it snowed there since. Well, anyway, that was that year in New Orleans. With my third experience of not having to apply for a job, Rudy had decided he'd go back to Cornell to get a PhD. By then I was pregnant, and so we left New Orleans, and we went to Cornell. We got one of the student housing things, and I expected to have a baby. Well, we spent the summer at Cornell, Rudy getting ready for his degree, you know, getting his committee set up and everything. And I was just getting ready to have a baby. Well, the baby was born dead. And it was possibly, not certainly, but possibly attributed to the fact that there'd been a German measles outbreak, which affected quite a few of the students when I was teaching at that Episcopal school. So I was exposed to that German measles virus. Mm-hmm. Now, when the baby was born, they could see no sign of whatever. It might not have been that. But nevertheless, it was in late August, and the baby, we had named her Laura, and she was born dead. So here it was, late August, I was at Cornell without a baby, very depressed, and my husband suggested that I should try to get a PhD, which I had tried to do, you know. And so I was not very, I was sort of reluctant to do it, but on the other hand, it turned out to be easy. And the reason it was easy for me to start and do it was because I was interested in ethology, and the person who taught ethology at Cornell was a man who had taught ornithology when I was there as a graduate student, and I had taken his courses. I'd studied under him, and he knew me. So I went to him and asked if he'd take me on as a student, and he said yes. And he said, I also know a project for you. And it was to study the behavior of sunfishes. And the reason he suggested that was because ethology was a new science. This is animal behavior, you know, study of animal behavior. And it was a study originated by a man named Conrad Lawrence, whom I knew all about. I'd read his books. And the people in Europe had already studied the behavior of two of the most prominent fishes of Europe. One was a family of cichlids. And the cichlids had a common sort of similar group of fishes in North America. These were the sunfishes of North, the centrarchids. And my major professor, Bill Dilger, suggested that I study the behavior of centrarchids. So I took it on. It was easy for me to do this because Rudy was an ichthyologist. He knew how to handle fish tanks. It was a big help. I couldn't have done it without him. But he collected fishes. We put tanks in the apartment we lived in. And I studied sunfish behavior for 3 years. And I had a baby during that time, another child. This was Mark, my oldest son. And he lived with us in that apartment with a dog, our first dog, Tam, for about two and a half years, I guess. And then Rudy got a chance to study when he graduated and he got his degree. I still hadn't finished mine when he finished his. And I still had to write a thesis. And so that last summer I was in Cornell, I spent the summer writing, longhand, if you will, my PhD thesis. And my major professor in botany took care of my baby. She was wonderful, the wife of this professor. She took care of Mark while I wrote the thesis. And then I went home to Indianapolis and had another baby, because I was pregnant by this time again. And my father died while I was in Indianapolis. And Rudy and I decided to leave me there with Mark and Tam, our dog, for the baby to be born in Indianapolis instead of in the Netherlands, where he was going to go to study with this ethologist that he'd gotten this, you know, a postdoc with. So he went off to the Netherlands. I stayed in Indianapolis, had a baby, and had to decide how and when and under what circumstances to finish my degree and get to Europe. Mm-hmm. So I spent, I think it was from August to about maybe early December in Indianapolis with this new baby who was born in September. And then I went back to Ithaca with a new baby, but not the dog. My mother decided to keep Tam, and she was going to keep him for a year while we were gone. So I took the two babies, went back to Ithaca, took my PhD exam, trying to remember all this detail, and then took the babies and flew off to Europe. And I'll always remember that PhD exam because when I went in, I told these three men who were on my committee that I had to be out of there by a certain time because I had to nurse my baby. And of course, this is unheard of. You don't tell your PhD examiners how long they can take with you, torturing you. But anyway, they let me go. And at the end, Bill Dilger, this really good friend of mine, said, "Helen, what are you going to do with your PhD? You're going to end up being..." I knew he thought I'd just be a housewife and a mother because I already had two kids. And he said, "But I wish you luck." And so I went to Europe. And you want the story of Europe?
Sure.
Okay. We lived in an apartment that was owned by somebody who was on sabbatical in the United States, just as Rudy and I were sort of like a sabbatical in Europe. And the apartment below us was owned by a man who was a doctor and his wife, Carla Overbeck. And they had one little girl who was Mark's age. And so we were above and they were below, and they immediately got acquainted with us. And Leekia and Mark played together most of that year. And it was very good for Mark because he didn't have any toys. And of course, Mike was an infant. But Michael was the most active infant you can imagine. He learned to crawl almost before he could cry. I don't know. Anyway, the whole time we lived there, I can remember him crawling all over that apartment. I'd have to go chase him. And the reason it's kind of interesting is because he later became a very good, top-notch crawl swimmer. Hmm. You know, he was one of the top swimmers in Oklahoma when he went to high school and stuff. But anyway, so in that year that I spent in the Netherlands, I met a woman who lived down the street who was English. And she was a great Agatha Christie fan. She had lots of Agatha Christie books. So she loaned me her Agatha Christie books. And all year long, I read Agatha Christie mysteries and watched my babies wash diapers. And the people at the lab where Rudy was working learned about my paper, and they took it, sight unseen, read it, published it in the journal Behavior. The whole journal took my entire thesis and published it.
Wow.
At the time, Behavior was the most reputable behavior journal in the world. So that was a kind of a clue, something valuable for my biography, if you want to know.
Mm-hmm.
Well, anyway, my paper was published almost before I left the Netherlands. And when we on the way, okay, I'll give another funny story. On the way, one of the men at Rudy's lab taught at the University of Edinburgh, and he was studying cockroach behavior, just as an aside. But because we got to know him fairly well, he invited us to stop at his house in Scotland on our way home from Europe. And of course, it was an invitation we could hardly refuse, and we did. But before we left, he came to our apartment and he says, "I have to tell you folks that the house you're going to be living in Scotland is haunted. There's a woman ghost there." And of course, we thought that was wonderful. He said, "You needn't be afraid, but I warned you to know ahead of time in case she appears." Well, we had bought a Volkswagen van while we were in the Netherlands. So we took that, drove with our two kids, took a ferry, I think, to England, drove north to Scotland, and got to this house. And when we got there, it was dark and it was raining, and it was a very scary kind of night. Well, we moved into this house, which we knew had a ghost in it, and that night Mark got sick. He cried, and you could tell he was just in terrible pain, and I didn't know what to do. He had a high fever. Rudy, with all the courage in the world, I thought, went out in that storm to look for a doctor. And later he said he remembers seeing the sign of a doctor when we drove by in this little town that we were in. And sure enough, about an hour after he left, he came back with a doctor, believe it or not. And he knocked on the door and got this man out of bed. And the guy came and he diagnosed Mark with the measles.
Oh my.
So we had to call these friends of ours who were loaning us the house and tell them that their two children had been exposed to them. I'm sorry, I forgot to say that they were there at the house when we got, no, were they there? I don't remember. Well, anyway, the first, we thought they should know that we had the measles. And that I know why. We stopped at their house when we were on the way up there and met their children and exposed their children to the measles. So we thought they should know. So they came up to the house, and they arrived the next day. But we spent that whole week taking care of one child with the measles and waiting to see the ghost. And the interesting part about it was, that when the doctor who came that night, that first night, he said, "Have you seen her?" He said, "Don't be afraid of her." And he was referring to the ghost. And every time he came, he'd ask, "Have you seen her?" And when I was out with the buggy and Michael, who was just, see, he was just an infant, still, I was wheeling around in a buggy. I'd take him for a walk. And the people would say, "Have you seen her yet? Have you seen her yet?" And we always had to say no, and we never did see or hear that ghost. But everybody in that town firmly and absolutely believed in that ghost. She was, it was a woman who had lived in a house that burned down. And this cottage that our friends owned had been the carriage house. And she was haunting the carriage house. Not everybody can tell a ghost story.
No. Wow. Well, from Scotland, did you finally make it back to the States?
Yeah, when we were in the Netherlands, Rudy knew he had to get a job. So he was applying for jobs in the United States. He was applying with the Fish and Wildlife Service and with any university which was advertising for an ichthyologist. And there was one job that he was hoping to get, I think, with the Fish and Wildlife Service in New Jersey. But they wanted an interview. And we couldn't afford to send him for an interview. So the only place that was willing to accept him, sight unseen, was Oklahoma State University. And they agreed to give him a temporary one-year appointment, sight unseen, on the basis of his resume. We didn't want to come to Oklahoma because I had had a history of bad experiences with tornadoes. Another interesting story. And I didn't want to come here, and Rudy wasn't particularly interested in coming here. It wasn't a very prestigious place. But it was the only place that would give him a job, so we came thinking we'd be here for a year.
And then look what happened.
Anyway, we got here. Well, we drove our Volkswagen, you know, across country, stopping at Rudy's parents to visit them in New York, and my parents in Indiana, where my mother was living alone with, remember, our dog Tam?
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of an interesting story, too, because we expected to bring Tam out here with us. But when we got to Mother's house, we stayed for about a week with her. And when we were ready to leave, packing up and everything, Tam was hiding the whole time under Mother's bed. And when we got to when we were taking the stuff out to the car, he was under the bed. And when we got to the car and closed the door, and Mother was standing in the door waving goodbye to us, here comes Tammy, and stood there and watched us go. He chose. And he stayed with my mother until they both died. He died a year or two before she did, but eventually she brought him out here. But anyway, we drove from Indianapolis out here, and we came in on Route 51, and somebody had been spraying herbicides on the vegetation out on Route 51, and everything was brown and dead. And there was a detour over to South Stillwater, and we had to drive through South Stillwater, which at that time was a black neighborhood, in order to get to the house of Dr. Jones, who was head of the department. And boy, was that a good impression of Stillwater.
Well, I was going to ask you what your impressions of Stillwater were.
Oh, it was awful. And that isn't the end of it. Dr. Jones had arranged for us to have one of the student housing apartments. And I had dressed up in my best dress to meet this department head who was going to be Rudy's boss. And so we drove up to the house, and he talked to us and for a while. And then he got in his car and drove us over to the student housing, which is still there. Our apartment, the one we rent, is still there. They've built a lot more. But anyway, it was a second floor apartment. And when we walked into that apartment, it was covered with red dust. You can just imagine how that would. And we were ready to move in. So I had to, while they stayed in the car with Dr. Jones, I had to get together and mop up and clean up that apartment enough that we could move into it. I got my clothes dirty. Everything was just filthy when I got through with that. It took me a long time to clean it up. Finally, we did move stuff in, and that was how we moved into an apartment at OSU. And I was used to taking my kids out on walks. I wheeled Michael and Mark walked. So one of the first things I did after we got settled was to try to take this walk with him. There were no sidewalks, because at this time there were cow pens, I think, on the right side of Farm Road, and there was a barn on this side. It was all dirt and all farm stuff out there. There was no place to walk, really. And so that I never walked these kids after that first day. And the first semester I spent with the kids in that apartment. And I made some friends, there were some interesting stories connected with the friends I made there too. But at the end of that first semester, I was offered a job teaching biology in the zoology department. And that was because Rudy had told the department head about my background. And the zoology department, the microbiology department, and the botany department shared responsibility for an introductory non-majors biology course. They had to staff the lectures and use graduate students for the labs. And the zoology department people hated to teach that course, the people who were zoologists. The botany people hated to teach that course. But here I was, a perfect person. So at the end of the first semester here, I was offered a job to teach biology. Fourth one, you've been keeping track. Never interviewed the department head. He just took Rudy's word for it. I suppose he could have checked. I don't know whether he did or not, that I had any background. They never asked me to show any kind of resume or anything, any diploma, anything.
They just took your word for it.
They just took my word for it, Rudy's word for it. And so I started teaching biology. And
were they large classes?
Oh, they were these huge. See, these are non-majors. Mm-hmm. They were huge classes. And I had two sections. And about the same time, I'm not sure whether it was that first semester or the next semester, they hired Becky Johnson to teach also. But I do remember that the first couple of years that we taught that course, we didn't have an office. We didn't have a desk. We just, we had sort of a transcript for what was supposed to be going on, I guess. We didn't have a desk. We finally got a desk in what used to be a coffee room in the zoology department. No windows. The two of us shared the desk. We put our books and stuff in different parts of the desk. And it was years before we each got a separate desk. And finally, office spaces of our own. It took forever. And the first 3 or 4 years that I taught biology I was an assistant instructor, I guess, a part-time instructor. Becky and I found out that we were paid less than the janitor in the building and less than the graduate student that was coordinating the course. Becky and I were not very happy. We were not very happy campers because we were so, you know, just, it just seemed to us that we were just not being treated right. Mm-hmm. So she was very active in the women's movement, which was sort of developing even here at that time. I did not participate very much because I had too much to do. I mean, I was a mother by that time of three kids. Leslie was born the year after we got here. 2 years after, second year, I guess, when we were here, she was born, my third child. So I had the problem of children and husband and family and the whole bit. We moved out of that apartment into a house the second year we were here. By that time, I think Rudy had decided he kind of liked it. He liked the people. I had a job.
Stillwater grows on you when all those things fall into place.
Right. So anyway, that year, the second year I was here, one of Rudy's colleagues was John Thornton. And his wife, Beth, asked me to join a bridge club. And I had learned to play bridge when I was at Tulane because Rudy played bridge at Tulane. And I had learned so I could play with him. And so I joined the bridge club. The second semester I was here, I joined that bridge club. I've been in it ever since.
So you were telling me about bridge club.
Oh, yeah.
And I want you to work back around towards your pay equity. Did anything ever happen with that?
Of course I got a raise eventually. But I have a funny story because one time what do they call these little things you get when you have a Chinese dinner? Fortune cookie.
Mm-hmm.
I got a fortune cookie which said, you will get a pay raise. So I stuck that in my drawer, and that was in that drawer for years. And one reason why I couldn't get many pay raises was because Rudy was department chairman for some years. He couldn't give me a raise. When he left that job, John Thornton got it, and John gave me a raise, and I threw the fortune cookie away. But I was never, I thought, paid really very well. And but it was not as bad as it was in the beginning, of course. Bridge was, during the years I've been here, Bridge was one of my group of friends. The other group of friends I had was the Audubon Society.
Well, tell me how that got started. I believe you were involved with its beginnings.
The Audubon?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't remember how long I'd been here, probably just a few years, when somebody from the Audubon Society, National Audubon Society, came up to me and asked me if I'd be interested in developing a chapter of the National Audubon Society here. There was an Audubon Society here. There were a lot of women who were birders, but they didn't want to be affiliated with the national chapter. So I agreed, and I got John Couch, who was a lawyer in town, to help me, and the two of us did the paperwork that was necessary to apply for, and we recruited some people, some of the old members and some of the members who wouldn't join us because they didn't want to be part of it. And we set up and we got a small group of people together to be a Payne County chapter of the National Audubon Society. And I was the first president of that. John Couch was the second. But I was president for two or three years. I don't remember now. I guess you can only be president for 2 years. but I held every office available in that, every possible office available to anyone in that organization in the years to come. And I have been going to their meetings all these years and being a member of that chapter until this past year I quit going, because the meetings were at night and I just couldn't handle the driving at night and the walking and everything, so I quit. So I guess I pay my dues, but I'm not really a very active member anymore. But the Audubon chapter here still prospers, in spite of the fact that the Sierra Club had to give up here years ago. But the Audubon Society is still doing pretty well, partly because we have a wonderful, Tim O'Connell is very active in it. I don't know whether he's president, he's been president. And Susan Walker is very active in it. And they have a lot of people in that department over there that are active in it. And they keep it supplied with graduate students and students to come to the meetings.
And there's a scholarship?
Oh, well, yeah. A couple of years ago, we established a couple of scholarships. And one was given to the man who raised the most money for these scholarships. And one was given to me because of, I was the first president, I guess, and the longest member. So there's a scholarship in my name, yes.
So, let's see, if you could guess, how many students do you think you've taught biology to?
I have absolutely no idea.
Hundreds?
Oh,
thousands?
Thousands. I mean, I have 100 in one semester.
And where did you teach these classes on campus? What building?
Well, they were in various buildings. I mean, the classes were in various buildings. Anywhere where there's a large
lecture.
Mm-hmm. Large lecture room. I taught in the classroom building, I taught in Nag Hall, I taught in probably those two were the most frequently used buildings. Did you also know that I taught other courses?
Tell me about those.
This was introductory biology for non-majors, and there were people on campus who wanted their students to have 4 hours of biology without having to spend time in labs. So the biology and botany department got together and decided to offer some two-hour courses. And I offered to teach. I was already into ornithology, of course, since I'd been a birder at Cornell. And I was learning birds out here, so I offered field ornithology, which was taught in the summer. And I offered human origins, which was just a subject that I was really interested in. So I developed a course around it. And I taught, environmental science, but I was leaving that to last. I thought there was another one. Anyway, I taught those 3 2-hour courses, human origins, and
environmental science
and field ornithology.
Mm-hmm.
I taught a lot of extension courses.
Hmm.
For the extension department.
Mm-hmm.
In the summer I taught birds of Arizona and birds of South Texas. And I taught for the, there was a unit which taught classes in the summer for elder hostel people. And I taught birds of Oklahoma. People would come here from all over the country so they could see scissortail flycatchers, roadrunners, prairie chickens, and painted buntings. Those are the 4 birds that everybody wanted to see. Yeah, I did. I taught those courses along with biology the whole time I was, almost the whole time I was here.
And how did you get the nickname Killer Miller?
I have no idea. I have no idea. You heard that, huh? I wasn't going to mention it. I hated that.
Did you really?
Yes.
Were you a tough teacher?
I thought it was unfair.
Really? Why is that?
Well, because I was no harder on my students than any of the other teachers were. Mm-hmm. But I guess some people thought I was, and it matched. I think it was a Killer Miller. If my name had been something else, they probably wouldn't have attached that name to it.
It probably would have been a nicer sounding
name. I hope.
Well, do you ever hear from through the years back from your former students?
Yes. Quite a few of them, as a matter of fact. One of my former students, I hear from all the time. I don't know if you want to hear this or not. Ann Riddells was a student of mine. She was one of the... Did I tell you that I wrote the lab manual for the biology course?
No, you did not.
Well, I did. Almost as soon as I started teaching, they needed a new lab manual. As soon as I got in charge of it, I wrote the lab manual for it. I spent one whole summer, I think, writing it. And Ann Riddells was a graduate student at that time, and she contributed one of the labs. She suggested how I could develop one of the labs. She was a graduate student. Well, she later worked in the graduate student office here on campus. Then she got a job with a computer company on the campus at Cornell. Then she got a job with a computer company in San Diego. And she finally got a job as the assistant director of the Cornell Laboratory of Ornithology. She was there for a couple of years and then finally quit that job, I think because she has a very strong personality, and I think their personalities clashed. Mm-hmm. Anyway, she quit, and she runs her own business now, but I hear from her all the time. And there's another graduate student who works with people on the reservation out west. The large Indian reservation, not Hopi, but
Cherokee.
No, I don't think it's
Chickasaw.
No. It's Western.
Western.
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Well, anyway, she works there teaching Indian students. And she was so motivated to be able to get help for her students and for her classrooms that she got herself a PhD so she could apply for grants and stuff, and she does that. She was one of my students one time. I could look her name up.
Did you write other texts?
Yeah.
In your spare time?
In my spare time. I wrote an environmental science textbook.
And that's probably before it was a hot topic.
No. There were already lots of environmental science books out there.
Really?
There were quite a few. But I got interested in environmental science as a biology teacher, and just reading about all the stuff that was going on, it aroused my interest. And when I went to the University of Washington on a six-month sabbatical one time, I studied with Gordon Oriens, who was an environmentalist. I took one of his courses, and while I was out there, I started writing by hand an environmental science book. I worked on that for years, and I finally got a publisher interested in it. It was the Mosby Publishing Company, And they took my manuscript, which by then I'd typed, and they took my chapters, chapter by chapter, and sent them to reviewers. And the reviewers would make comments. There was a panel of reviewers, or probably about six or seven people who taught environmental science. And those people criticized and rewrote my chapters. So then I'd take those, rewrite the chapters, resubmit them to the panel, and they'd go, so it went through twice. So I had, at the end of that process, I had a book which had been reviewed by a panel of reviewers twice. And then Mosby decided they didn't want to get into the environmental science textbook field. They fired the editors that I'd worked with for 2 years, and they told me that they just weren't interested in the book anymore. I believe them because they never have submitted an environmental science book. I think they just decided the competition was too much, and they didn't want to, they just decided it was a poor decision.
Mm-hmm.
They'd spent a lot of money on it. But I had an environmental science book, which had, you know, which was in pretty good quality because it had been reviewed by so many people. But I submitted it to a few publishers, and they turned them down. There are lots of environmental science books out there. So I don't know that it'll ever get published. Interestingly enough, my daughter was in contact with a publisher over another matter and asked kind of casually if they were interested in an environmental science book, a new one, and they said, yes, do you have one? So my daughter is now working on that book to submit again. It's in good shape. I keep it up to date. I have three books which I keep up to date. One of them, of course, is environmental science textbook. When I couldn't get that published, I thought, well, maybe I could just take some of the material from it and make a book out of it that would be published or could be used as a text without all the pedagogy and everything. So I did a book called People and Their Planet, How People Change the Planet was the name of it. And I kept that up to date, and I tried to get that published, no luck. And so then I did, 2 years ago, I took the last chapter of the textbook, which was called The Biosphere is a Commons.
Uh-huh.
I took that last chapter and developed it into a book. And that book I'm now trying to sell without much luck. But this one is a much more marketable and I think a much more important book. It's for general consumption, and the whole name of it is The Biosphere is a Commons, Can We Save It from Ruin? You know what a commons is? A commons is something that's owned by everybody and owned by nobody.
Mm-hmm.
That is, has everybody has access to, but nobody owns. It's available for everybody to use. And of course, a commons is subject to ruin if you overuse or abuse it. The idea of a commons was first introduced to literature by Garrett Hardin, an Englishman, who told this story about how in England there was a group of people who lived in a village, and they had a huge pasture land which they all grazed their livestock on. And it was a commons because everybody used it. And they used it for years and years. And then one year, one of the members of the village decided that, heck, he'd like to put another cow on this pasture. And so the other people decided, well, we will too. And finally they had put so much livestock on the commons that it was overgrazed and didn't support any livestock at all. This was a ruined commons. And that fable is what he used to express his concern about the commons, that is the biosphere. The biosphere consists of living things. It's a thin skin of, around the planet's hard surface, consisting of all living things, soil, air, climate, and water. And those things have always had elements or the characteristics of the commons, because we've always been free to dump anything we wanted to into the atmosphere, always been free to dump anything we want to into the water of the earth. We've always been free to use or misuse our soils. And as far as climate is concerned, it's a little harder to think of that as a component, but it affects soils, water, and soils, water, and atmosphere. So it's really part of the commons. And of course, right now, it's the one that's being changed the most by free access because of carbon emissions and methane emissions.
Well, hopefully somebody will be interested in it.
I hope so. Well, I think people ought to know this.
Sure.
I have a passion for people understanding the problems we face. I really do.
Even in retirement.
Even in retirement. Even at the age of 78.
Well, looking back, how did, you know, you ended up coming to Stillwater. You didn't think you were going to be here that long.
No.
How did teaching at OSU and being in Stillwater impact your life?
Oh, well, it was... My husband, of course, was the one who made all the decisions in our life. Actually, that's true. And his decision-making was always good. But he was the one who decided to stay when they offered him a permanent position, or at least, you know, an assistant professorship. And because he had, in 1 year, learned to like the faculty, and he thought he was going to like hunting. He learned to hunt. And so for a couple of years, he was a hunter. And he hunted birds. He hunted ducks and pheasants. But he never hunted deer, he never hunted geese, but he did like the hunting that he did. Now he's sorry that he ever did any of it, but that was another reason why he stayed, was because he was getting a lot of the lifestyle. And the second year we were here, we bought another house, which was a nice, very nice house. So we were comfortably situated. We loved our house, and the kids were pretty happy here. I was pretty happy with my job. Well, I wasn't very happy with my job, to be perfectly honest, but it was a job.
Did you want something more?
No, I didn't. I wanted a better, I think I wanted better pay, better recognition maybe. But Becky Johnson and I went through a period where we were so dissatisfied that we began writing novels. I never told you that. I've written four books. First one was a novel. And she was going to write one, I was going to write one. And the reason for that, the reason we decided to do that as a way to just, you know, get rid of our frustrations, was because I knew a woman who had had two novels published. They were both romance novels. And I thought, heck, if she can do it, I can do it. And I told Becky this, and she says, heck, I can do it too. So the two of us started. I don't know whether she ever finished hers, but I wrote mine. I was having arthritic pain in one hip, and that hip was bothering me a lot that year. And I wrote that novel to get over my hip pain. I had to use a cane to get around on campus and everything. And I finished it, and I never, ever looked at it again. It's still in my closet, sitting there.
Was it a romance novel?
It's a romance novel.
How about that?
How about that? It'll never be published. I'll never show it to anybody. But I did write it, and I did finish it.
And that's what matters.
You know, it's fun.
Do you feel that sense of accomplishment when you finish writing
something? Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. It's kind of frustrating not to have anything published. Of course, I wrote the lab manual, which was published. I guess I could count that. And I've written quite a few articles that were published. I've had articles published in the publication of the National Western Heritage Museum. Mm-hmm. Persimmon Hill magazine. I've had published articles in the Outdoor Oklahoma magazine. I've had articles published in the Oklahoma Observer, which is a statewide newspaper. And I wrote a column called The Nature Trail for the News Press for several years. And I wrote an article published in The Birder's World.
Where's the best place in Oklahoma to see birds?
What kind of birds?
Well, say you name the four, the Roadrunner, the Scissortail.
You can see all those around Stillwater. But I guess probably the most, if you to answer that question, might be the Great Salt Plains. Mm. Mm-hmm. Because there are a lot of migratory birds that go through there. Another place is there's a big wildlife sanctuary down in southwestern Oklahoma. Just right down the corner. It's a big, big preserve, big sanctuary.
And you have three kids.
I have three kids. Mark is my oldest son. He is a, he works for, he lives in, Edmund works in Oklahoma City, and I have a son, Michael, who lives in Japan, is married to a Japanese woman. He's an oceanographer and ocean fish, he's an eel specialist. He knows more about eels than anybody in the world. And Leslie, of course, works here in Stillwater. She writes for the Fire Protection Publication Services. And I'm very grateful to her for living here. She, you know, most people, if they have daughters, they expect to go to live where their daughters live when they're older, and so they can be with their daughters. Daughters are handicapped in that they have to take care of their parents when they're old. Well, anyway, Leslie left here and went to Berkeley. And she spent a year in Berkeley, and I thought she probably would get a degree and get a job and go somewhere. And we expected to someday follow her. But what did Leslie do? She came back here. She didn't have a job, but she very quickly got one, and she's been here ever since. And we're very grateful that she came back, because we didn't have to move. It's just an interesting side bit.
Mm-hmm. Well, looking back on your life, when history is written about you, what would you like for it to say?
Well, except for you, history's never going to be written about me. But I care about the environment. I like to teach. I had five near-death experiences that I survived. I must have been destined to do something useful. I wonder if that could be that book, which may alert people to some of the problems that we face. So far, that hasn't materialized, but I want to know how I want to know my near-death experiences.
Yeah, sure.
The first one was when I was leading youth hostel trips in Europe. We were riding through Rotterdam in the rain, and youth hostel leaders always have to be at the back of their group. And I was at the back of a group going along on a bricked street. And I was riding along, and all of a sudden I was on my side. I'd fallen, my bike had slipped out from under me, and I felt a car go by and hit my head. And another car screeched and went around. I missed death by car crushing my head by not even an inch in that episode. And I have a feeling that if there's still somebody alive in the Netherlands who is older than I was, they lived to tell the story about how they almost ran over the head of a bicycle rider, because two cars almost killed me. That was the first one. The second one was when I was leaving. No, the second one was when I lived in Oxford, Ohio. I was sleeping one night in my upstairs apartment in a house, and I woke up with my hair just standing on end. I felt it was just energetic. And I ran to the window, and there were leaves blowing down the street. The trees were bent like this, way over. It was pouring rain. And I thought, oh my, we're having a real storm. I hadn't heard any thunder. But I went back to bed, and the next morning the news was just full of the fact that Hamilton, Ohio, which was about 5 or 6 miles down the road from Oxford, had severe damage from a tornado that touched down that night. And the tornado path they traced in the paper had knocked out some livestock barns and other farm stuff just south of Miami, where Miami, Oxford. And that path went right over my house. And so I know I was under a tornado, which if it had been down any further, any lower, might have really wiped me out. So I consider that my second near-death experience. My third one was when I was leaving North Carolina's Duke University Biological Station to return home to Indianapolis. I was meeting a friend who I'd met in Europe the year before, who was coming to this country. He was from Denmark. And I had been up all night finishing a paper which we were supposed to write as part of the curriculum at that lab. And I was really sleepy, but I couldn't stay another night because I had to meet Finn. So I was driving very sleepily, and I woke up at one point, and there was a car coming my direction on the grass on the other side, and I was on his lane, and he was honking like crazy. He woke me up. If he had not avoided me, we would have crashed head on. I could have died in that. So I was very much awake after that, believe me. But anyway, that I consider that my second death experience.
So we had the bike, the tornado, the car.
That's three. Mm-hmm. Okay, I had triple bypass surgery, and I was in the recovery unit. They thought I was okay. But one night I got up, and I remember that I had to go to the bathroom, and there was a guy who was holding a bedpan, and I fainted in his arms. And the next thing I knew, I was up, I was in bed, and they were showing me my hand, which was absolutely black. I had had a swarm of blood clots.
Oh my gosh.
Which had developed as a result of that surgery, but it was a delayed development. But that they tracked that blood clot swarm all over my body. They had heart people, they had liver people, they had brain people, they had, because if it had settled in any organ, I would have been dead. But they settled in my arm. And my left arm at that, I'm right-handed. So I was happy about that event, which could have caused me to die. I mean, that was a near-death event. I was in the hospital for weeks after that. And they thought I would die, of course, when they were tracking all those blood clots. The other time that I had a near-death experience was when I pulled a tick from right here, swollen off of me. And two nights later, we were watching the debate between, I think it was Gore and Bush, second term debate, probably in October. And I got up, went to bed, and that next morning, Rudy couldn't wake me up. I was in a coma, and I knew about the tick, but I don't know whether Rudy did. But anyway, they took me here and flew me to Tulsa, where I was in a coma for about at least a week before I woke up. And when I finally did wake up, they called Mike from Japan. He'd had time to get there. He was by my bed when I finally opened my eyes. But they didn't know whether I was going to live from that for a while. But then when I woke up and Mike, pretty sensible, I seemed to be okay. I went to rehab and did, the kind of exercises you always do when you're coming home from the hospital. And when I got home and I put on a pair of shoes that I always wore, they were just comfortable sandal-like shoes. I couldn't keep the shoe on my right foot. It just would not stay on when I walked. So I realized there was something wrong with my right leg. And I kind of blamed it on that virus that had caused me to be so ill. They had done a test on that virus, and it showed a mild reaction to Rocky Mountain spotted fever, but I didn't have any spots or anything like that. They ended up concluding that they could not identify the virus, which had caused me to have this go into a coma. But the fact is, ever since then, this was in 2008, I have not been able to walk right. This leg just gets worse and worse. I can't walk correctly. That's the reason I use it. It just doesn't want to work right. It's a funny thing to say, but it just doesn't want to work right. My leg doesn't work. There's a problem with the knee. Well, anyway, so that was the other near-death experience. And interestingly enough, I have a friend, one of my Bridge Club people, who knows of a man in Texas who had a tick bite that sent him to the hospital. And when he got home, he was incapable of walking at all.
Wow.
So there is a virus out there that does this to people, but apparently it's not very common. It's not really recognized. They haven't been able to diagnose it. But this is my biggest problem right now, is not being able to walk very well.
Mm-hmm. Too many close calls.
Too many close calls. But maybe it was meant to, for some good reason.
Well, usually. Usually.
Well, you know, I enjoy being alive, so that's enough, I guess.
Absolutely. 9 lives.
Even though I can't walk very well, but yeah. Wow.
Well, is there anything else you'd like to share with us that we haven't spoken about today?
I think I've told you an awful lot.
Well, we appreciate your time. Thank you so much for sharing your stories with us.
You're very welcome.